not for today. Today I'm gonna use this empty box, an amazing music CD, this Fujifilm camera, and this incredibly boring IRS 1040 income tax form to show you some really cool stuff about Fujifilm video files. Hi everyone, welcome to Pal to Tech. Today we are talking about the video files that your Fujifilm camera creates. For today's video, I'm going to be using this Fujifilm X-T4 camera to demo, but keep in mind that the information that I'm going to be providing pretty much applies to most mirrorless cameras. Now, when shooting still photographs, your Fujifilm camera gives you the option to save either a JPEG or a RAW file on the SD card. If you're unclear about the difference between JPEG and RAW files, I do have a video on the subject that I will link to down below. Now, when shooting video, you also have a choice. You can choose a higher quality file type, but at the expense of larger video file sizes and more work that you're going to need to do later on in post-production. Now, the area that you choose your video file type is right here, called file format. Now, before we go any further, you need to understand that the process of shooting video produces huge files. If you were to shoot video on your Fujifilm camera, the same as shooting raw photographs, you know, raw files from the camera sensor, your SD cards would not be large enough to store them. Likewise, delivery, editing, processing, they all become much harder with these type of uncompressed video files. So what do we do about it? Well, luckily, a system has already been developed to deal with this problem. It uses two main components, containers and codecs, that manage your video files that are saved onto the SD card. Let's start with containers. Because shooting video doesn't just involve video, but also audio and additional metadata and other information that all needs to be kept together, your Fujifilm video files are stored in containers. There are two choices of containers that Fujifilm gives you, MOV and MP4. MOV was created by Apple, and it works best in their system, while MP4 is a more universally used container, and it has more flexibility. Think of a container as a box. So, in this MOV container, you have your video file, okay? You also have your audio. And lastly, you have that boring information that basically tells you what it's all about, all the different settings and programming. That's the metadata. Okay, you should now know what a container is. And if you go into the settings of your Fujifilm camera, you will see the type of container that you can choose, located in the first part of the selection menu choice right here. You see, we're getting a better understanding of this stuff already. But hold on, we're not done yet. Not only are the two containers called MOV or MP4, but the actual files themselves that you get on the SD card use those names as their file name extension. File name extensions are very important because they tell the computer or your device how it should handle the file. For example, right here I have a JPEG file and it has a JPG extension. You see that? This tells the computer to open Photoshop or Apple Photos or whatever to view and edit and manipulate this file. However, if I change the extension to, say, PDF, look at that, the computer is confused. And if I try and open it, doesn't work, right? The reason I'm making such a big deal about this is because it is very easy to think of MOV or MP4 as simply the video file type because it uses the extension MOV or MP4. However, from this point forward, you must always think of them as a container MOV or a container MP4. It is a box with video, audio, and a tax return inside. So now the second component is called a codec. Codec is more or less a combination of the words coder and decoder. A codec is basically a computer algorithm that is used to compress down your video file size. The idea behind a codec is to keep your video file sizes as small as possible, while at the same time keeping the quality as high as possible. And there are many different kinds of codecs. Some are better than others. Your Fujifilm camera uses two types of codecs. The first is called H.264. Think of H.264 before as being similar to a JPEG. It can be easily edited, easily shared, and pretty much universal wherever you decide to publish it. You know, it's just like if you can drive a stick shift on a car, then you can drive any car that's made. And if you use H.264 codec, you should be able to drive your video pretty much wherever you want to. The next type of codec on your Fujifilm camera is called H.265. H.265 is also known as HEVC, and this stands for High Efficiency Video Coding. Now, this is a much newer codec than H.264. However, it can give you the same quality as H.264, but at only half the file size. In other words, from an efficiency standpoint, it's twice as good. However, because it's so new, not many computers and devices fully support it yet. In fact, on some post-production editing software, playing back H.265 video will be jerky and stuttery as it's trying to play and cause the computer to stutter. Now, there's a way to manage this in post-production, most notably by using what are called proxy files, but that's beyond the scope of this video to talk about today. The bottom line here is that you can definitely edit and work with video files that use the H.265 codec, but depending upon the type of computer that you use, it may require additional time in post-production. You will be seeing the H.265 codec on more and more devices as it becomes more universally adopted. Heck, right now, even this iPhone uses that codec. Check this out. Have a look at this. If I record at 4K 24 frames per second, that's one thing, but to get 4K at 60 frames per second, I have to use the High Efficiency, or HVEC, codec. In the file format area, now when you look at this, you know the first part. That's the container we talked about earlier. Now you know the second part. That is the codec. You see that? Now the last part, where it says LPCM and AAC, that has specifically to do with the type of audio compression being used. LPCM stands for Linear Pulse Code Modulation, while AAC stands for Advanced Audio Coding. For simplicity's sake, let's just say that shooting with LPCM is more or less like shooting with raw files, uncompressed audio, while shooting with AAC is more or less like shooting with JPEG files, where you have lossy compression. All other factors being equal, obviously you will get a higher quality source file audio for your video project if you use LPCM. Okay, so now you know that there is a container and a codec and a specification of audio compression type in every Fujifilm video file that you choose to shoot with. But what does have a significant impact on video quality is the bitrate that you choose. Bitrate is simply the number of bits per second during the playback of your video. Just think of bitrate as how much data can be transferred per second, and the higher the bitrate, the less compression has been applied to your video by that H.264 or H.265 codec, which results in an overall better quality. Higher the bitrate, better the quality. Have a look at this. The footage on the left is being played back at 400 megabits per second, while the footage on the right is only 1 megabit per second. That's the effect that a low bitrate has on a video. Now, you choose bitrate for your video right here. Do you see that? But look, some of the options are grayed out, and that takes us back to which codec and which container that you choose. All these various aspects work together, and some are not compatible with others. For example, if I decide to shoot video at 60 frames per second at 200 megabits per second, you see that? And I go into my codec and I change it to a lower file size codec. Let's say H.264 right here in the MP4 container. Have a look at this. Do you see how the movie mode changed to yellow? Look at that. The camera dropped it down from 60 frames a second to 30 frames per second because that was what was compatible with the codec and the container that I had switched it to. And you'll see that it's now grayed out. Look at that. I can't choose it. However, if I go back, but But let's say I change it now to the MOV container with the H.264 codec. Now I can go back in here and choose 60 frames per second. Now I'm gonna have a much larger file size, but I can choose to shoot at 60 frames a second and so forth. As a general rule, if you use the MOV container with H.265, you're gonna have more options with regard to your frame rate and your bit rate. But wait, there's more. There is one other setting here that also factors into all of this, and that has to do with your two movie compression options located right here. You have a choice of either all intra or long gop, right? Now, I need to make a full video on just those two options and all the pros and cons of using each. I don't have time to do that today, and frankly, this video is long enough already, and I'm already starting to get a headache from all this stuff. In a very basic nutshell, long gop stands for long group of pictures. And if you choose this setting, you are telling your Fujifilm camera that when it applies the codec compression, the camera should only really track the changes between each frame of video that you shoot. So look at this video of me right now. I'm moving, right? But look at behind me. Not much else is moving. And therefore, if I were to shoot this in long gop, this video right here would have a much smaller file size. However, if you're panning your camera, say at birds flying through downtown New York City, you might have a lot of stuff changing from frame to frame to frame in your video. In that case, all intra compression applies itself to every single frame individually. Frame, 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 like that. And as such, yes, you're going to have much larger file sizes. However, when it comes to post-production, your computer will have a much easier time in the editing process of those files, since they are one complete frame at a time. And lastly, whether you choose to apply long gop or all intra compression, that will have an effect on what frame rate and other options that you can choose. For example, if I choose the H.264 codec in the MOV container, and I choose all intra as my movie compression, now when I go into movie mode, I cannot shoot at 60 frames a second. It's grayed out. However, if I go back and I change my movie compression to long gop, if I go back into movie mode, have a look at this. Now I can change it to 60 frames a second. It's enough to make your head spin. Well, thank you so much for watching. I hope you enjoyed the video. And if you did, be sure to give it the like and subscribe. I will see you in another video, this one at 400 megabits per second in the H.265 codec in the MOV container very soon. Take care.